What was that?
Jones, what was that?
It's the main beam. The crack grows.
Do we sink?
Will not hold. We must turn back.
Turn back or what?
The weather tears the ship apart.
Mercy on us.
She cannot be put into repair.
Are you men bent on destruction? Will you argue even with the ship's master now?
We have hazarded much and suffered too many crosses to quit this hatchet without discourse.
We will die in discourse.
Hold your two willing tongues. Your families will be safely back in England in about a few months' time.
A few months for you? Some of us have borne this yoke for a dozen years or better.
Tiny herd, quiet run.
These passengers are known to history as the Pilgrims. In many ways, their story is that of every immigrant who has come to America to start a new life. As with many immigrants, their story begins thousands of miles away. It is told through the writings of one man who lived it.
That I may truly unfold the story of Plymouth Plantation, I must begin at the very root.
Hosea, chapter 3, verse 1. Religion is the best, and the corruption of it the worst. Neither hath greater mischief and villainy ever been done amongst men than that which hath marched under the flag of religion.
Amen.
Then said the Lord,
I shall endeavor to manifest this history in a plain style with singular regard unto the simple truth in all things.
Double vengeance unto them who
at least as near to the truth as my slender judgment can attain.
This is William Bradford. Much of what is known about the Pilgrims comes from his words.
Thou shalt abide for me.
In 1607, he is an orphan living on his uncle's farm.
So will I also.
But his passion is theology.
And without a prince, and without a sacrifice.
This famous and worthy man, John Robinson, was our pastor for many years.
And without teraphim.
Mr. Brewster, a reverend man like a father to me, became an elder of our church.
Love a woman beloved of her.
These two men guided us in all things. It is they who labored in this secret church to have the right worship of God and discipline of Christ according to the simplicity of the gospel. Yet others persisted to disturb the peace of our poor persecuted church.
Return and seek the Lord their God.
Master Brewster! Master Brewster!
Go and engage whoever it is in some discourse.
But what shall I speak of?
Use your wits, lad. Tell him I've been called away on postal business.
Hurry, man, make haste.
One wouldn't know it to look at them, but these worshippers are breaking the law. The official state religion is the Church of England. It was established 70 years earlier, in 1534, by King Henry VIII. He placed himself at the head of the church, replacing the Catholic Pope in Rome. English Protestants were overjoyed. They saw England joining the great Protestant Reformation of Martin Luther and the overthrow of the old Catholic Church.
The old church had power because it said that it could help people to get to heaven by saying masses for their soul. Luther and the Protestants said that wasn't so. God had all the power, we have none. And by saying that, they said that the old church had no power. That is what split the Western world apart in the 16th century.
But real change in the Church of England is slow to come.
In the early 17th century, the Church of England still had remnants of the past, like stained glass. The church still had bishops and priests and deacons with cathedrals, choirs. In other words, it looked rather more like the old church, and a lot of Protestants did not like that one little bit.
Some feel the King's Church can never be purified. They must separate from it completely.
That's the difference between a Puritan and a separatist. Puritans simply wanted to change it, make it better. Separatists made another big leap of the imagination. They say you shouldn't have a Church of England. You shouldn't have a church which is connected with the civil power. And in the 16th century, that's a very big deal.
Good eve. Who is there?
It's George Averill, lad.
The church warden.
The John Robinson leads a meeting here tonight.
But there is no one here other than me.
If you delay much longer, I shall collect the constable.
For 30 people to gather in a house in the depths of the country would be considered unusual and perhaps dangerous. What were these people getting together for?
Master Avril.
It would be quite likely that someone would be inclined to report that to the local governor, who in turn would report it to the government. It was always possible that someone would betray you. Perhaps a servant who was discontented, a neighbor who didn't like you. It's a world where all eyes are upon you.
The average churchgoer in the period would look at the separatists and see them as fanatics. In 1607, the apparatus of the church courts swing into action against the separatists of Scrooby. Quite how this process begins, we don't know. It must be a denunciation to the local church court. Allegations of separatist activity are taken really quite seriously, and this goes right to the top.
What moved them to protest?
They do pick through the Book of Common Prayer like a woman at market, taking what they like and rejecting all else.
James is an intellectual. He likes ideas, he likes discussion, he likes debate. James is also a very practical politician. He's a man who's grown up in the rough school of Scottish politics. He is the son of Mary, Queen of Scots, who had spent 19 years as a prisoner in England and was eventually executed for treason. James was kidnapped half a dozen times before he was 18.
Aye, but what fault do they see in it?
They say they shall give passive obedience to your majesty, but could not give active obedience to any unlawful thing which should flow from your bishops.
Active and passive obedience?
That was the phrase of speech, sir.
I'll tell thee, man, what obedience is. The centurion, when he saith to his servants, go, and they goeth, that is obedience. I will not have every Jack or Tom or Will or Dick to meet and censure me in my council.
King James thought that he was God's right-hand man on earth. And most monarchs did at the time because the Bible told them that. James was a profoundly religious man, but the biggest thing in his religion was obedience.
You can't have political stability unless you have religious unity.
I will have one doctrine, one discipline, one religion, in substance and in ceremony. I will make them conform themselves, or else I will harry them out of the land, or do worse.
People who deviated from the Church of England were going to be persecuted. It wasn't quite like the Spanish Inquisition, but they would be harassed. They could be imprisoned, they could be fined, and it was true that the previous monarch, Queen Elizabeth, had actually hanged people who were separatists. And so there was always that threat.
These were brutal times when a monarch felt that his control over the ideological purity of his realm was being challenged. They did not hesitate to imprison people forever, essentially. There was no writ of habeas corpus. You went into prison, and if you came out, you were just lucky. Most of the time, you went into prison and got sick and died.